We begin our action items with the first one, 4.01, policy 1450, and I call on Mr. McElveen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I move that the school board adopt policy 1450, non-discrimination, as detailed in the agenda item.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Moon. I now call on Ms. Schultz. You have a motion. Mr. McElveen, I understand you don't want to speak at this time. All right. Ms. Schultz, you have a motion.
I move to postpone policy 1450 until the second school board meeting in October 2015.
Again, I ask that this is a business meeting. I understand you're all here in support of one side or the other, but I do ask that you respect the fact that this is our business meeting. Ms. Schultz, please continue.
I move to postpone action on policy 1450 until the second school board meeting in October 2015 so that the board can be provided the commensurate draft regulation and handbook language and determine the overall impact of the proposed revision to policy 1450.
Is there a second to this motion? Ms. Schultz, you may speak on your motion.
Before the board tonight is a main motion which has generated more spontaneous public discourse and commentary than I believe in the history of Fairfax County Public Schools. The motion to defer or postpone that main motion is offered for substantive, critical issues which deserve the full due consideration and unanimous support of all of my colleagues. Whether a class of students with gender-related issues may hurt individuals in the bathroom is not the issue before this board tonight. It is about the right of 99.7% of all students. All teachers and all employees to retain their right to privacy, safety, and dignity. Those rights of all students, all parents, and all employees are respected and protected has not been addressed by this board. There has been no information provided to this board about the scope of the issue regarding the number of FCPS's 186,000 students this involves, the scope of the issue regarding the number of FCPS's 40,000 employees this involves, the regulations which may be involved about who is responsible for navigating the issues, most importantly, at the classroom level, and the impact that this may have on stress and workload for our educators who are already stretched to their maximum in so many respects. We have no information about the practices that FCPS currently carries out and does well or does not do well. We have no information on what safety and security issues exist now in FCPS's 194 school buildings, countless administrative buildings for all employees. And although I am a mother of four boys, I have deliberative concerns for your daughters, your granddaughters, your sisters, your aunts, your wives. Your wives and your mothers, happy early Mother's Day, because after all, I am each one of those. In seeking information about what this policy may mean, and that was inordinately and surprisingly difficult, not because of the lack of ability on the part of a highly competent FCPS staff, but because of the lack of the very existence of the information I sought on your behalf, my significant concerns begin with our budget. Significantly in the face of an $8 million budget shortfall, which has not yet been resolved for fiscal 16, and facing a $100 million shortfall for fiscal 17, there is absolutely no information about the potential cost of outcropping of any of this policy decision, including staff development, facility modifications, staffing needs, and more. In a division that has cut nearly $500 million, it is fiduciary malfeasance on the part of this board to undertake passing any policy without understanding the germane cost associated with any such action. Money. The latest development of this board being faced ostensibly with a mandate from the federal government that this school board, like FCBS, the 10th largest school system in the United States of America, is being forced into policy language development under the threat of having federal education monies yanked is simply unconscionable. That the federal government, via the Office of Civil Rights, under the U.S. Department of Justice, through the U.S. Department of Education, is compelling individual local school boards around the country, or risk losing federal education monies like Title I funds designed for the neediest children, most at-risk students, hungriest children, is unconscionable. Is my federal government, the Department of Justice, the Office of Civil Rights, and the U.S. Department of Education really threatening me as a duly elected local official who has sworn an oath to the Constitution of Virginia to run this school division in accordance with Virginia code, requiring me to run it with utmost efficiency, quote unquote, to do their bidding by inserting gender identity or any other language into our policies or face taking our children's lunch money? There are 14,000 school divisions in the United States of America. What about the 90,000 other school board members? Do I have a right to run this school division as a locally elected official under the Virginia Constitution by the people who elected me? The federal government is telling me no. Yeah. There are serious concerns about not having regulations and understanding impact for policymakers like the 12 of us sitting here who have to run the Fairfax County school system. If we do not understand germanely, germanely and with compassion, how to respect every student, every employee, and most of all, every parent's rights who have entrusted us to educate your children. We have to delay this vote.
Mr. Stork, would you like to speak to your second?
I respect the right of all board members to make amendments and motions, and in that light, I was willing to second her motion, even though I will not be supporting this amendment. Thank you.
Ms. Reed.
Thank you, Chairman Derenette Koufax. Apologize for being late. I was at another meeting, and I had every intention of seconding this motion, so. Y'all may as well get comfortable. It's gonna take a little while. I've been on this board for 6 years, and I've used a level-headed, analytical approach to make informed decisions. I also care deeply about our students, employees, and members of our communities. It is with these same qualities that I approach tonight's vote in which the Fairfax County School Board will decide on whether to expand its non-discrimination policy to include gender identity as a special protected classification. As we know, this policy not only impacts students, but also teachers and employees of the school system, which is the largest employer in the Commonwealth. I don't know if you know, but this issue also has been proposed to be added to our SRNR, Student Rights and Responsibilities, tonight as well. So if that catches anyone by surprise, we'll be talking about that again later. Ms. Schultz and I didn't compare notes, but you might hear a few common themes. I took an oath of office that states I will faithfully and impartially discharge all of the duties incumbent upon me as the Providence District representative to this school board. It is my job to be objective and to consider the views and interests of everyone I was elected to represent. I also have a responsibility to govern and to lead. I want to first thank everyone that contacted those of us who received hundreds and hundreds of emails, those of you who are in the audience and outside and watching on TV. We've received an incredible amount of feedback on this issue. People feel very passionately. I've read the emails, I've had conversations, I've asked lots of questions of staff. I met with Logan, a transgender student, and I talked with my sister-in-law about her April, who is now AJ. It is important for me to make my decision-making transparent. Whether you agree or disagree, at least you will understand my thinking. In summary, I want to reinforce the message we teach every day in our schools, that all students should be free from discrimination and harassment so they can feel valued and achieve their full potential as students and future members of society. I believe our current policies might do this. My support in postponing this decision is not about compassion or rights or one segment of a population. It is about whether our board is being responsible or foolhardy. Frankly, the process we've used to get to this point is troubling and embarrassing. I have so many fundamental questions that remain unanswered. Some answers were coming in as late as 2 and 3 o'clock this afternoon. If the board can't answer these questions, then a vote is clearly premature. Now, being the good analyst that I am going to take the time to identify what some of those questions are. Why is the board rushing to address this issue at this time? Why have we not followed our typical processes for policy development and implementation and public engagement, as outlined in our strategic governance manual? This issue was first raised at our forum on March the 12th, 2015. It was brought for new business April 23rd, and a vote is scheduled tonight, as you know, May 7th. We clearly have caught the public by surprise and not done justice to our established public engagement process.
Ms. Reed, please continue. Please continue, Ms. Reed.
And to prove that I have, in fact, read all these emails, I've also included some direct quotes from people. I won't use your name. But this adds flavor, and I think it's important to understand the comments that people are raising. Why has this not been publicized to parents? For a school system that is so good at keeping parents updated through email, Facebook, and other school resources, I was a little confused why I hadn't heard about this vote and why it was not publicized. I can only come to the conclusion that FCPS did not want the parents involved in the discussion. This week, our board has been pulled away from other important pressing business. We have not adequately honored our teachers during this Teacher Appreciation Week. Nor have we wrestled with how to honor our highest priority of employee compensation when we received $7.6 million less in our transfer request, let alone the $100 million plus shortfall projected for FY 2017. I have not heard about nor worked on closing achievement gaps or anything else that is a priority noted in our agendas or our strategic plan. Someone writes, I implore you to focus on the issues that are putting the reputation of our schools in jeopardy, such as budget shortfalls and less competitive teacher salaries. I would love to spend time working to improve these things in our schools rather than worrying about ad hoc policies that the board is trying to impose. Furthermore, to put this rush job in context, it took this board over 10 years of study to institute later high school start times. And near and dear to my heart, over 5 years to study whether to hire an independent school board auditor. It is safe to say that historically, this board rarely rushes into decisions. Question two, do we have the legal authority to do this? The impetus to change and expand this policy was introduced by Attorney General Mark Herring in an opinion on March 4th, 2015. However, his opinion contradicts 8 other Virginia Attorney General opinions. These opinions all concluded that the Virginia General Assembly is the only body with authority to establish or change public policy to define classes for forbidden discrimination under Virginia law. Someone asks, have you considered the legal fees should you be sued for rashly following Mark Herring's opinion? I also asked the question, what interpretation does Fairfax County government take on this issue, and have not heard the answer to that. Other questions, and I apologize, colleagues, I warned you I was going to be lengthy. Three, is this change required, and by whom? What are the legal implications of not doing this versus the perceived threats of pulled funding? I won't cover that because Ms. Schultz did a very good job, and I'll spare you. Costs are another issue. This seems like it's an unfunded, I won't even say mandate, I don't know what it is. But what are the estimated costs to comply with this? And what exactly are we talking about? Is this change necessary? Someone wrote, is this even an issue to be addressed or is it already a protected status? I don't know. The current FCPS non-discrimination policy prohibits discrimination based on sexual orientation. And the Office of Civil Rights guidance says that transgenders are protected under Title IX. Someone writes, through 200 years of precedent, our Supreme Court has determined that classifications such as race, gender, alienage, national origin, voting, interstate travel, and privacy are protected by the 5th and 14th Amendments. This is why I find it difficult for school board members to take it upon themselves to determine new classifications of students. Nobody condones bullying or discrimination. And this and this is not about some people mattering more than others. Someone wrote, I believe all students should be a special protected group and their best interests should be evaluated in light of the uniqueness of each child by the individuals who know them best, their teachers, administrators, and parents. We're only on number 5, folks. What is the problem this vote is trying to fix? How are we going to do it? What is the current status in our schools? Can we cite any specifics about why this came about? Have there been incidents of discrimination? I don't know. Can we cite other schools that have made this decision or any statistics? What kind of research have staff and the board done to get to this point? Have we done a literature search? Have we looked at case studies? Have there been community meetings and debates? No. And the big question really is, how will this be implemented? It seems like such a simple change on its surface, but what are the pros and cons of making the decision? What are the potential second and third order and more implementation effects? Have the implications of keeping the status quo versus making the change been thought through from all angles? Someone wrote, it is not even clear about what the board will be voting on, given no regulations have been written for review and consideration. It's like writing a blank check. Do you write blank checks in your personal life? No. In conclusion, yes, colleagues, finally. Two citizens said it best. Quote, being in a position of responsibility, we expect our representatives to be prudent, informed, and judicious when casting their votes on our behalf. And lastly, someone wrote, please take time and study the issue. Remove emotions and strive for facts. If the board has not fully studied the issue, I urge you to stand up and be a leader and admit this publicly.
Ms. Reeder. Please continue.
I urge my colleagues to support this amendment. Thank you.
Would anyone else like to speak to Ms. Schultz's motion to postpone? I again just ask for your respect. Ms. McLaughlin.
Before I share my perspective on this, I would like to find our general counsel. Mr. Foster, I think one of the most important things that we can be doing first and foremost as leaders of this school system is to help provide important education about what we're doing here tonight. And first of all, as I understand, this is a policy update. We are not creating a new policy. We are not changing. It's not a new policy. It is
McLaughlin, I do ask that you do speak to the motion on the table, which is the motion to postpone.
Yes, I know. I understand it's about the motion to postpone.
Thank you.
But
please
I think in order for the audience to understand, at least for this board member, Megan McLaughlin, on why I am not going to support postponement, is that I want some information for the audience for people to understand some clarity here, because with all the respect that I have for every one of my colleagues sitting here at the table, there is definitely a difference of opinion about what information the board has, what we know, and why we may not believe that a postponement is necessary at this time. So Mr. Foster, I had asked earlier that in terms of the existing policy as it is, where we do not have this additional language. Is this additional language needed in order to provide the protection for our transgender population in the school system, in terms of protecting them from discrimination?
I've previously advised the board and provided you my recommendation, and that is, you understand what that recommendation is. The recommendation is that this policy be amended. You're absolutely correct. As many speakers have noted this evening, we are currently dealing with transgender students in our schools. Our policy does not reflect that, okay? There's also been a recognition by many speakers, including the maker of the motion, Ms. Schultz. The federal government has been very clear that they expect local school divisions to amend their policies to include gender identity. Okay.
But as I understand it also, Mr. Foster, that Title IX does already provide this type of protection. So for this postponement, it gives the impression.
Ms. McLaughlin, again, we are speaking to the motion to postpone right now. You may speak on this later.
I understand, Ms. Darnell Koufax. My point is, I think that there's confusion in the audience in terms.
Yes, I know.
I will just simply share this. What I do know, in extensive conversations with our superintendent and with her leadership team, I do not believe we need to postpone, because it is not about any change in practice. I have heard how we handle it. The misinformation about the fear that this will change bathroom practices in locker rooms and safety of our children is simply not true.
All right, the motion is... is the motion on the table to postpone was I move to postpone action on policy 1450 until the second school board meeting in October 2015 so that the board can be provided the commensurate draft regulation and handbook language and determine the overall impact of the proposed revision to policy 14. We've had a vote, we've had comments, we've had seconds. We will now vote on this. All those in favor of the motion to postpone. Ms. Schultz and Ms. Reed. All those opposed? That will be Moon, McElving, Hines, Smith, Derenak, Koufax, Velkov, McLaughlin, Stork, Strauss, and Evans. The motion fails. We are now back to the main motion. We are now back to the main motion, and what I ask that you allow us to conduct our business meeting at hand. Again, please, right now, I ask for your respect. We are now back to the main motion, and excuse me. Mr. McElveen will now speak on his motion, and again, we must conduct this business this evening, and we will ask those of you who continue to shout at us to be removed from this meeting. Mr. McElveen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Tonight we do have a slightly bigger audience than usual, and I would like to welcome you warmly, offer that to everyone to our meeting. For this,
okay, right here.
I would like to welcome all of you warmly to our meeting tonight on this debate on adding gender identity to our non-discrimination policy. Again, welcome to our house and our school system for a debate that is so incredibly important for the health and well-being.
Again, I am asking you one last time. I do have the ability to clear this room. If you would like to listen to what we are saying, then please listen respectfully. Please listen respectfully to what the board is discussing tonight at its business meeting.
Excuse me.
This is about all of us, sir. I am a parent in this school as well as a representative.
Chairman,
this is about all
Chairman,
of us.
Chairman Derenak Koufax, if you would, can I have a point of personal privilege?
No, you may not, Ms. Schultz. We will give you one more chance. We will give you one more chance to try, and then we will take a 5-minute recess. Because then, if we cannot conduct our business in the way we intend to, we will then have to clear the room.
I'm sorry, Chairman Derenak Koufax. With due respect, you must recognize me for a personal point of privilege.
Ms. Schultz, I will allow it. Yes, Ms. Schultz.
For the benefit of the people who are here to hear this argument, I'm imploring you want to be here for the discussion that's about to happen, because you need to hear what is about to happen. And I have a crystal ball. It's pretty good. You owe it to yourselves to hear what these people are going to say and allow them to conduct their business, and then follow on with any action thereafter. But if you don't let them have the meeting they're about to have and have the decision they're about to do, then you won't be here to hear it. So I ask for the extension of courtesy to my colleagues and Mr. McElveen, the courtesy I was extended to read my motion, to give him the same courtesy to finish his motion.
Thank you, Ms. Schultz. Mr. McElveen.
So again, I would like to welcome all of you here tonight for this very important debate on adding gender identity to our non-discrimination policy, a debate that is so incredibly important for the health and well-being of all of our children and employees in Fairfax County. For those of you who are interested in how our school board has arrived at this decision, and for those who may be concerned that this policy change might have arisen out of thin air, let me assure you that this board has been at the forefront of this cause for more than a decade. In 2002, this school board asked for an attorney general opinion on whether we had the legal authority to grant protections based on sexual orientation and gender identity. In March of this year, the Virginia Attorney General ruled that we can, in fact, protect our employees and students from discrimination based on gender identity. That brings us here tonight to finish the work that so many of our colleagues before us and among us have pioneered. Our Fairfax County Public Schools today are places noted for their inclusiveness, with students coming from every country in the world and speaking almost every language in the world. We do not tolerate discrimination, not based on race, not based on age, color, sex, sexual orientation, religion, national origin, marital status, or disability. And tonight we will declare that we do not discriminate based on gender identity either. The truth is, we already do not discriminate based on gender identity in practice, but that protection has never been clearly outlined in our policies, and its implementation has been left up to our well-meaning staff. So the purpose of tonight's vote is to reaffirm this board's belief that we value and accept all of our students and employees for who they are. In FCPS, we have an increasing number of students self-identifying as transgender and as gender nonconforming. These are our most vulnerable and at-risk students, and it's critical for our board to ensure that they feel welcomed and supported at the highest levels of our system. The rate of suicide attempts among transgender and gender nonconforming people is staggering. Whereas 4.6% of the overall U.S. population has self-reported a suicide attempt, 41% of transgender and gender nonconforming people surveyed have attempted suicide. We cannot ignore these statistics, and we cannot lose one more life of a student who believes that they aren't accepted by their society or by their school system. Just imagine if these were your children. You'd probably do everything in your power to support them. As a board and as a community, these are our children, and it's our duty to protect them. Unfortunately, in response to our effort to protect these members of our community, fear and distrust have been sown in our community. As a society, we never would have made progress if we had given in to unsubstantiated fears that we have heard tonight. The pioneering Marie Curie once said that nothing in life is to be feared, it is only to be understood. In other words, the fears about this policy change are unfounded and need to be better understood. Fears we have heard relate to claims that, with this policy change, our practices will change, leading to a wave of students and staff self-identifying as transgender, allowing men uninhibited access to women's bathrooms and locker rooms, and encouraging teachers to cross-dress in the classroom. I cannot emphasize this enough. After we pass this policy tonight, nothing will change in how we handle cases of transgender and gender nonconforming students and employees. They will continue to undergo a thorough vetting process with school staff, as they always have, to ensure their claims are legitimate and made in good faith. This board has never received a concern regarding a bathroom incident of this nature. We have never received a concern about a transgender staff member. And we have never received a concern about a transgender student playing on a sports team. Never. This reflects how well our staff has handled these situations to date. In fact, a task force of our staff has already been working very proactively to ensure the fidelity of implementation of these practices at all of our schools. Finally, and most importantly, as you've heard tonight, we are, in fact, being compelled to make this policy change by the Office of Civil Rights of the Department of Education, which has directed all school districts in the United States to amend their non-discrimination policies to include gender identity. In this light, amending this policy is non-negotiable, unless we want the federal government to come after our federal funding. To conclude, I would like to speak about our role in history tonight. Many of you might not realize how the building in which we are gathered, Luther Jackson Middle School, relates to our discussion tonight. So let me explain. This school was named for the founder of the Negro Voters League of Virginia, and it served as the only black high school in Fairfax County. For years, black students had to be bused here, some taking hours to get here to receive their education. This year marks the 50th anniversary of desegregation of Fairfax County Public Schools. You might wonder why it took Fairfax County until 1965 to desegregate, more than a decade after Brown versus Board of Education, which declared state laws establishing separate public schools for black and white students to be unconstitutional. The leaders of our state organized massive resistance to desegregation and put us on the wrong side of history. Friends, 50 years later, we are fighting the same battles that our forebears fought. To provide equal access to our facilities for all of our students. The push for protections based on gender identity is the civil rights issue of our day. It is well past time for Fairfax County to be a leader on civil rights issues. Not delay this vote and relive our checkered past by putting ourselves at risk of legal action by the federal government, all while standing on the wrong side of history. I appeal to my colleagues, as we gather tonight in this relic of our past injustices, to search inside for our best selves in tonight's discussion, selves that do not turn to injecting unwarranted fear and misinformation in our community, selves that do not relive the civil rights mistakes of the past that drove us to Seneca Falls, Selma, and Stonewall, but instead envision Fairfax County as Virginia's leader in proactively protecting all of its students and employees, no matter their gender identity. I am so proud to join all of my colleagues up here tonight. After all the years it has taken to bring us here, to stand on the right side of history. And I am proud that 50 years from now, when a future board is debating the new civil rights issue of the day, right here in this room, our board will be remembered not for postponing, not for delaying civil rights, but for protecting all of our employees and all of our children.
As we move forward to our speakers, I again ask you to listen to what Ms. Schultz had said. Please, Mr. Moon.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As Mr. McElveen has spoken so eloquently on the need to make this policy update, I will not speak too long or repeat what he has already done. As we all remember, in November of the last year, after we learned that United States Supreme Court refused to overturn an appeal to avoid the same-sex marriages in Virginia, this board, by the vote of 11-1, passed my motion to add sexual orientation to our policy 1450. So that, please, do not, even if you agree with me, do not interrupt me. So that our school system does not discriminate anyone based upon that person's sexual orientation. The policy update had been a long time coming. As I remember, the school board, a number of years ago, discussed exactly the same issue, but was reluctant to ignore the then standing Attorney General's opinions. with the most recent one coming from the former Attorney General Ken Cuccinelli in 2010. Whether you agreed with the former Attorney General's opinions or not, they were the opinions that the school board at that time gave deference to. I am giving the same deference to the new Attorney General Mark Herring's opinion issued in March of this year, that the school board in Virginia have the authority to add gender identity in its non-discrimination policy. People may disagree on whether the Attorney General Herring's opinion was correct or not, but that is the Attorney General's opinion of the day, and I am going to give my due deference to it on the question whether this board has authority to add gender identity to its non-discrimination policy. On the need to add gender identity to policy 1450, I absolutely agree with Mr. McElveen that this is a civil rights issue. As long as you, whether an employee with us or a student, are not violating any of our rules or regulations, should never be discriminated based upon who you are. A student's right to education is a fundamental right, and that right should not be infringed upon based upon who that student is. Over the last couple of weeks, we have received, and I do not know exactly how many, but perhaps almost a couple of thousand emails on this particular issue. I have not been able to read all of them. But regardless of which side on this issue the senders of the emails were, almost all seem to agree that we should not discriminate against anyone based upon gender identity. Most of the objections seem to be based upon the fear, and I must say, the unfounded fear that their children and our students will somehow be immediately harmed by this policy update. But as Mr. McElveen pointed out, we'll not be changing that what we have always been doing. The school administrators will meet with anyone claiming to be a transgender and ascertain whether such a claim is supported by legitimate evidence, medical, legal, or otherwise. Our students do not need to fear, and I support the motion.
Ms. McLaughlin.
For those of you who don't know my history in this county, I am a parent. I'm in my 14th year with Fairfax County Schools. I have three children. Before I joined this board 3 years ago, I spent almost 10 years, like many of you, caring about our schools, serving on the PTAs, in leadership, becoming a parent advocate and a community advocate. I helped co-found the Fairfax Education Coalition back in 2009 with the expressed goal that we would improve this school system in its accountability, its transparency, and its community engagement. And that's why I feel so strongly about tonight's policy update, because that's exactly what it is. Regrettably, there has been tremendous amount of misinformation in the public. Every one of you who has sat here tonight, I have not heard you say that as of today, you have been worried about your children's safety. As of today, those of you who have children in our public schools, you have felt they are safe. And it's because they are safe. They were safe today, they were safe yesterday, and they will be safe tomorrow. So I would like to read for you something very important that I think speaks to the exceptional leadership we have here in Superintendent Garza, and what gives me confidence about this policy update in adding two words to confirm what she has already been doing, she and her administration. And as she has noted, we are responsible for all students. And while we sometimes have to accommodate students with varying needs, we can do so in a manner that is considerate of all students. We currently accommodate a few students, providing them access to the use of other facilities, like single-use bathrooms. We know that our administrators have done an exceptional job in meeting the needs of every child in the school. We know, as Mr. McElveen has noted, that there has not been a single case brought to the superintendent, to this board, about a child being uncomfortable, a child being fearful of their safety, of parents being fearful of safety. So keep in mind that what went from a simple policy update to confirm the practices that we already do in this school system, which I heard all of you championing that we do not discriminate. That's all this does. It confirms what we have been doing so well, which is to not discriminate and to meet the needs of each and every child. I would also like to point out that one of our speakers who gave us some legal analysis, and he cited some federal decisions about the courts where they've rejected certain practices. What he didn't speak to is that they're not rejecting the policy update about the protection to not discriminate. So this policy update, I believe, reflects the values that we hold dear here in Fairfax County, which is we don't discriminate. We do not discriminate. Because of the reassurances in my communication with our superintendent, with the thoughtful leadership that she and all of those who have been part of Fairfax County for so many years and have kept this school safe for all students, I have every confidence that this policy update, what it does signal to our community and most importantly to our children, is to respect one another, that there is dignity in every single one of us. For those of you who are concerned about your children, I will tell you that in listening and speaking to our leadership team, they continue to work day in and day out with each and every family on any given issue where they are concerned about their child's welfare and well-being. And I would ask you to look at the facts. Unless you can point to where this school system, in its current practices, that this policy simply affirms, if you can't point to any problems that our practices have given to date, then you should leave tonight with confidence knowing that this school system tomorrow will continue to be the safe and outstanding public school system that you are here tonight to celebrate.
Ms. Hines, followed by Mr. Lateef.
Thank you. In this environment, I will go ahead and try to say what's on my mind about this and explain how I come out and why, for the sake of those who came tonight. I do want to thank Mr. McElveen for bringing this forward. I think it is something that we need to do. I think the speakers so far in favor of this have spoken very eloquently, and I can't add much to it. I would say we have all been reading the emails. We've been doing our best to take them all in. I have responded to some who've written in, trying to understand better what the worries are. I won't use the word fear, because I think that gets people upset. So worries, I hear worries on both sides, honestly. I think one of the reasons that we even think about protecting this group of students is because we are worried for them. We know what they've been through, we've heard their stories, and we know that their worries are real, that being in this group of students, being transgender or being having a different gender identity than others around you is a difficult way to go through school, and we heard that just tonight from a former student. So I think we're protecting them, we want to protect them because we're worried about them. So that's the worry on one side. The worries on the other side, I think come to questions about
things that I don't really think we're doing right now. And one of them is, but I do understand why people's minds go to these places, right? So if we're saying that we will not discriminate against transgender students, people right away start thinking and talking about bathrooms and locker rooms and what will be the practical implementation of this. And I get that. I think Ms. McLaughlin is right that legally, we are expected to have a non-discrimination policy. We're not legally required to do anything particular with our bathrooms. We're not really legally required to do anything in particular at all, other than make sure that as we implement this, we do it in a way that protects the safety, privacy, and dignity of every child. And that is how we do things in Fairfax County, which is why I also feel comfortable setting the policy. That's our job as the board. And the implementation will follow, and I have faith that it will be a good implementation. It will be good for all of our students because we're already doing it. We know how to do it. And I will tell you, the reason that I think we need to make sure that we make this statement as a board is that I think there are people, when I listen to some of the language that I've been reading in some of these emails, and this is not everyone, but there is fear of the other out there. There is fear of difference. There is, I'm not accusing anyone in this room of that, but we've gotten many emails, and I could read you some of the quotes, but I won't because they're very hurtful. And if some of those people are bullying other students, bullying teachers, bullying administrators, then I want everyone in our school system to know that this board protects them and intends to protect them and intends to keep everyone's safety, privacy, and dignity as our top concern. So I will proudly support this.
Mr. Lateef, followed by Ms. Evans.
Hello. First, let me preface this, but I do ask for your attention and your cooperation in letting me finish my remarks. I'm the student representative here. I speak for your children and all 187,000 children in Fairfax County. But you don't know what I'm going to say. You don't know what I'm going to say. I'm not even basically going to talk about this. All I will say is I've heard a lot of feedback from my fellow students from across the county, mainly positive about this change from the feedback I have heard. That's all I'm going to talk about when it comes to non-discrimination. However, I want to ask everyone here, I need you to do something for me and for your children and for the students of Fairfax County. Come budget time next year, I want to see this passion, I want to see this vigor, I want to see this community involvement when it comes to funding our schools, because that is a true threat to our children and a true threat to our community is the underfunding of our schools. We can't pay our teachers enough. We have cut $500 million since 2008. We fired over 2,100 teachers in that same time. And during that time, we've gotten 24,000 new kids come to FCPS. So we are overburdened and we are underfunded. And I ask that you bring this passion and this vigor for protecting your own children to those debates, worthwhile debates.
Ms. Evans.
Yes, thank you. I do want to thank Mr. McElveen for bringing this and Mr. Lateef. Those were excellent remarks, too. I appreciate that as well. As a school system and as a society, we must show compassion and understanding for all of our students. Adding gender identity to our non-discrimination policy will put this board on record as not tolerating bullying, harassment, or abuse of any kind against transgender students who are among our most vulnerable. We have transgender students in our school system now. We have an obligation, both legal and moral, to make sure these students are treated fairly. We also provide accommodations for transgender students now, and we have done so with little fanfare and little controversy. We will continue to accommodate these students in a way that makes the most sense for all concerned. In many ways, this is a symbolic action tonight. As you've heard, the U.S. Department of Education's Office of Civil Rights has told us, has told the school systems, that Title IX already includes protections for gender identity. and we are all bound by federal law. Adding this to our non-discrimination policy says that we agree that we cannot discriminate against our transgender students, and we will treat them and all students with fairness and respect. I support this motion.
Ms. Schultz, followed by Mr. Velkoff.
I'm not sure if I was longer than you, Ms. Reed, the first time around. I lost track, but hold on, colleagues. Okay. This past Sunday, I watched a story about the rise of a young 17-year-old woman who started as an intern and has risen to be the CEO and the first woman CEO of an automobile manufacturer in the United States. As a mother of two children about the age of two of my own, I was struck by Mary Teresa Barra's role as a leader in a massive organization. With a $2.6 billion budget and as the largest employer in the Commonwealth, FCPS pales in comparison to GM with 212,000 plus employees in 396 facilities and touching six continents. In being charged with improving, some would say even saving GM, her pragmatic approach in ending meetings sometimes on time at 5:30 to make her children's games left an impression on me. But the significant takeaway was her strategic leadership in taking something as simple as a 10-page dress code for their employees down to two words, dress appropriately. When faced with the notion that if a child doesn't fit into one of the named particular classes in our non-discrimination policy, that we are or will discriminate against them means we are affirmatively participating in discrimination for many of our children. That notion is preposterous. Earlier in our term, one of my colleagues championed a legislative package item advocating that the Virginia General Assembly press the United States Congress for an equal rights amendment to the U.S. Constitution. I didn't support that. It's not the business of the board. In November, one of my colleagues championed another policy change to this policy 1450 to add sexual orientation. I didn't support that either. And I spoke at the time about an ongoing subclassification of people due to special protections or treatments that they may be due because of some attribute. I posited at the time whether we should protect teachers who are parents because they will understand the children that they teach better, or those in their childbearing years and subject to time away from their positions as a result. Within months, that very thing happened with Young versus UPS that went to the Supreme Court. And Ms. Young is a Commonwealth of Virginia resident who was a pregnant UPS worker not afforded simple duties that would have been commensurate with her temporary needs while pregnant. UPS could take a page from GM, and FCPS should as well. Let's change the non-discrimination policy to two words, don't discriminate. I have two email excerpts I wish to share, which are voices which are missing from the public engagement on this topic, because there hasn't been any. The first is from an FCPS teacher. I do believe that it is FCPS's responsibility to make all students feel welcome and safe, but With that said, I do think we are responsible for all students and staff members within the school. Designating bathrooms for those students is without a doubt the right thing to do, but opening restrooms or locker rooms isn't the answer and it's not the point. If I'm misguided in what your intent is, which we haven't said, please let me know so I can inform all the other professionals in my building. Please note, I teach two students that consider themselves transgender or gender neutral. I have never spoken to either of them about which bathroom or locker room they use. They both approached me at the beginning of the year with an index card and said, please refrain from using male or female pronouns in class towards me. They prefer gender neutral terms. I am very conscientious as to what I say in class and how I say it, but I wonder what in this big world will it be like for these students when they are sheltered from the real world and, for lack of a better word, grocery stores, workplaces, and gyms. Please do not do this. The second voice is the voice of an FCPS parent. As a victim of severe adolescent age bullying that spanned several years and caused me to consider ending my life, I don't protest this measure lightly. I also generally think that the idea of a slippery slope is an overused and undersupported angle when people debate important issues. But in this case, this is truly a slippery slope. The truth is that people are bullied for many reasons, and students are bullied for many, many reasons. They're bullied for being poor, for rich, smart, having a low IQ, for the way they dress, for being too fat, too thin, too short, too tall, too awkward, for not dressing like everyone else, for the way they wear their hair, for the way they smell, for the way they speak, for the kind of cell phone they use, or for not having a cell phone. The list goes on and on. I once heard an LGBT advocate of the safe space posters that teachers are encouraged to put up in their classrooms say in response to this that I'm making, it's true, most kids don't try to kill themselves because they're fat. How sad and absolutely not true. It demonstrates a shameful level of ignorance. The bottom line is that the school system cannot protect all children from all things all the time, and not from those that society generally looks down upon or doesn't understand, but they can and should enforce a safe and comfortable learning environment for all students in the most reasonable way possible and make accommodations just like these. The problem is, in passing this, as we heard earlier, if there was a task force already underway, why is this motion before the board, before staff finishes the work of its task force? If we are already treating students and employees well, and as the maker of the motion, Mr. McElveen said, this policy will do nothing, then why are we passing the policy before we know what's in it? I have one last point to make. And the question is whether or not something could happen right away. And that is a big question mark, knowing that staff is not going to have any draft regulations or any handbook for this board to review until the 30th of September, which is after the next school year starts. And a series of questions from my colleagues and including myself were posed to and answered by staff. And one is a very interesting question, Being the parent of four children, one in college, one in high school, one in middle school, and one in elementary school, I consider myself composite mom. One of the very often posed questions that has nothing to do with bathrooms, that has nothing to do with locker rooms, but is a very real and present concern for which I have no answer, is this: what effect does approving the language have on immediate operational and personnel implementation, e.g., for example, if a teacher comes to school next Monday dressed and identifying with the opposite gender and the language has been passed, then what? This is staff's answer. This is staff's answer. We will work with the teacher, HR, and division counsel on a plan for that teacher. The teacher would not be allowed to use the bathroom of their choice. And as a practical matter, nearly all faculty bathrooms in our schools are single stall bathrooms, such that only one person at a time may use them. That doesn't address what happens in the front of the classroom and the rights of the parents to be engaged and to be heard.
Next, I have Mr. Velkov, followed by Ms. Strauss.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In the interest of time, I'm not going to read excerpts of letters. We've received, as you've heard, lots of them, and it's instructive to see the wide range of views in the county. But generally, the reasons for not making this policy change generally fall into these categories. One, the school board's process is secretive. Two, the U.S. Department of Education is bullying us. Three, males will enter female bathrooms, commit any number of acts, and then use gender identity as a defense to get off the hook. I'm repeating the things that people have said. The next one is that FCPS will allow transgender teachers into our schools, and then the children will not be safe. Number five, parents will lose their right to move their child from a class taught by a transgender teacher. Six, transgender employees and students are already protected. And finally, the lives of 99% will be disrupted for the sake of a fraction of 1%. So let me address each one of these in turn. The school board's process is secretive. Well, we are following the same process that we always do. We post action items as new business a week in advance. We accept public comment during the new business meeting. We act on items 2 weeks later at the next meeting, again after accepting public comment, as we did tonight. We meet here 22 times a year, and these business meetings are broadcast live. We hold more than a dozen work sessions each year across the street, and those are video recorded and posted to our website. At our last meeting, two Virginia delegates expressed gratitude that they were able to view our prior work session online. So the next time someone suggests to you that the Fairfax County School Board is not transparent, you might want to ask that person if they know why committee and subcommittee meetings of the House of Delegates are held at 7 o'clock in the morning, whether audio or video recordings of those meetings exist, and whether the delegates' votes are tabulated and posted for the public to see. The second issue, the U.S. Department of Education is bullying us. Frankly, I couldn't care less what the U.S. Department of Education thinks, and for that matter, the Virginia Department of Education. As far as I'm concerned, their missions would be better served if they were shut down and the monies were redirected to universal preschool. The next concern, males will enter female bathrooms, it will. First, today and forever, Anyone who enters the bathroom of the opposite sex for the purpose of observing others commits sexual harassment and will be dealt with accordingly. Second, today and forever, anyone who enters any bathroom and assaults anyone commits sexual assault and will be dealt with by the school system and the police. Third, the suggestion that transgender persons should be particularly feared for committing such acts has no basis in fact and is simply a witch hunt. It is a sad but true fact that 90% of sexual assaults of children are perpetrated by a friend or family member, and that almost 70% of these occur in the victim's home. As the father of two daughters, I have to tell you, the last thing that I worry about is the thought of one of them alone in a bathroom with a transgender woman. Next. The next concern, FCPS will allow transgender teachers in our schools, and then our children will no longer be safe. Well, as you've heard, there's breaking news. We already have transgender teachers and transgender students in FCPS. Each individual is treated with dignity and discretion, and accommodations are being made to the satisfaction of everyone. The reason that we haven't had a full-blown community engagement about this policy is because, frankly, nothing is changing. The notion that outside agitators promote that this policy change will cause a sudden massive upheaval is not true, and the proof is simply that we have been dealing with transgender persons in FCPS, and none of these catastrophic consequences has ever materialized. You see, because of the compassionate culture that characterizes our employees, we are dealing with the needs of transgender persons today as if they were already protected from discrimination. The effect of this policy will be that the school board publicly assumes responsibility for our treatment of transgender persons. Further, our action will foster the development of guidelines that will create uniformity throughout the system and will address the reasonable needs and concerns of all. Next, parents will lose their right to move their child from a class taught by a transgender teacher. Actually, parents have no such right at all. Parents haven't had rights like this since the abolishment of the Virginia Constitution of 1902. We've also heard this, that transgender students and employees are already protected and that this is unnecessary. It is true that sexual orientation and gender identity are already included in our anti-bullying regulation. However, the SRNR governs the behavior of students towards students and does not address the behavior of employees to students or employees to employees. You see, in Virginia, under the Dillon Rule, previous attorney generals have concluded that school boards are granted the authority to govern the behavior of children, but not of the adults. Finally, the concern that the lives of 99% will be disrupted for the sake of less than 1%. This majoritarian view was frequently expressed by constituents in communications to the board. The problem I have with this line of reasoning is that there are so many examples in American history where the consequences of such thinking led to blemishes on our past, or indeed, blights today. I'm reminded of the parable of the sheep and goats from Matthew 25. And I'd like to read a brief excerpt from the contemporary English version. When I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. And when I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. When I was a stranger, you welcomed me, and when I was naked, you gave me clothes to wear. When I was sick, you took care of me, and when I was in jail, you visited me. Then the ones who please the Lord will ask, when did we give you something to eat? When did we welcome you as a stranger, or give you clothes to wear, or visit you when you were sick or in jail? And as many of you know, the king will answer, whenever you did it for any of my people, no matter how unimportant they seemed, you did it for me. Madam Chair, without hesitation, I support adding the words gender identity to policy 1450.
Ms. Strauss.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Our schools must provide a safe and respectful place for all to learn and to work. Harassment and bullying for any reason, including gender identity, has no place in our schools. Fear gets in the way of learning. Our schools are a place of study and learning and growing. We cannot have fear. I support this policy update because it clearly states students may not be harassed or bullied for any reason. Thank you.
Would any of my colleagues like to speak first before I do go backs? Before I do go backs. Mr. Stork.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I learned a lot about this issue a few years ago when I became aware of a situation with a child in one of our schools who was very young, the age of several years old, 2 or 3 years old, and they weren't sure what gender they truly were. They were physically one gender, but they were not, that is not how they felt. As a school system, we provided that child the room and the parents because the parents were equally challenged about that. They were truly not sure about what to do, what to make of this, how to move this forward, how to address this with their child. But they cared deeply for their child. And that child is somebody that they wanted to be respected, somebody they wanted to help nurture who they truly were. And they were deeply appreciative of our school system as we carefully, gently, supportively helped that patient, helped that parent, and helped that child through the process, through their growing years in our school system. And I know that that child is a healthier person as a result. It doesn't matter whether they were a male or female. It doesn't matter whether they thought they were male or female. What matters is that child had something that he or she needed to work through. And working through that with the parents, who were also deeply concerned about the need to do that, was how that particular family dealt with this issue. And our system, our school system, is here to provide just that type of support to any child, regardless of where they're coming from. That is what we are about. That's what I believe we do. That's what we must continue to do. Doing right by all students, protecting each student, respecting each student and staff member. I think those are foundational beliefs that I have, and I think foundational beliefs of this system, and I'm working forward, looking forward, working hard to protect. I personally start with not discriminating based upon who the person is. I think that's wrong. I believe it is a basic right, it is the right thing to do, and it's something that many, many, many people have paid for dearly in the past. Our students are safe. They have been safe. This policy addition will continue to keep them safe and frankly will increase the sense of safety of those students who are most different from others. Passing this policy is the right thing to do because discrimination is wrong, is hurtful, and we need to make it clear that it is unequivocally the wrong thing for our society and for this board to be doing. That is why I am voting yes to add this gender identity to policy 1450. It is the right thing to do. Thank you.
I have two go-backs, Ms. Schultz and Ms. McLaughlin.
I just want to make perfectly clear that the irony that we're talking about language in a policy that if we don't implement it, then the federal government is going to come after our children's lunch money by withholding our federal education funds is story number one. If we don't implement it, children who have a gender identity issue will be affirmatively discriminated against, even though everything we've heard has said that our FCPS staff personnel do a stellar job addressing the needs individually and respectfully in each and every case, is problem number two. Problem number three is that we are put in a position that the Virginia Attorney General Mark Herring has had an outlier opinion that doesn't match any other. So say we go forward under his opinion and we incorporate this because then it aligns the state language with the federal language, which if you went back to number one, is the federal government forcing this policy decision. Because if what we're doing is working for our students and working for our employees, is respectful, is honorable, while we continue to honor and respect the rights of parents, the other employees, and the other students, then basically what we're doing is working very well unless I have a report otherwise. So now I'm back to, is it the federal government that's making me do this? And if the federal government is going to reach down and compel me as an individual, duly elected official of this school system, then they can do the same thing in 14,000 school districts across the country with any language at any time. And if that's the way the school education policy is going to be run in your school district, when things are going well and we are respecting the minority, the children with difficulties, whether it's students with disabilities, students with gender issues, students with stress, students with mental wellness issues, students with suicide ideation, these are all issues that we handle on a regular basis in a large and well-performing school system. So if we can't answer your questions about what this means in practice, if the practice is already happening, then why pass the policy? If the policy needs to be passed, if the policy needs to be passed in order to meet a federal mandate under threat of losing federal education funds, then let's have that conversation on a national basis, because that's the problem that's got to be addressed.
Ms. McLaughlin. Ms. McLaughlin has the floor.
I again want to say that as someone who has been a community advocate for almost a decade, your engagement on this issue, it matters. It matters. Yeah. Your engagement matters tonight, and it will matter again in the follow-on motion that you all need to be aware of. Part of the comfort level that the most important part of the comfort level that I have, and I believe many of my colleagues who support this, is number one, it was a policy update that we don't discriminate, and we're making that clear. What we also know is that through the follow-on motion that we will be voting on after this main motion is that the school board is going to be reviewing with the superintendent any recommended changes in the future that again protect the rights and the needs of every single student in this school district. So it is important that with this board, what we have heard you clap and applaud is that you do respect and understand the need to not discriminate. And that is what this policy update is tonight. Simply that.
Are there any other go-backs before we take a vote? All right, I haven't spoken yet. So the motion before us to add gender identity to our non-discrimination policy is simply to provide an environment that promotes equality where every student and employee is treated with dignity and respect. This tells our students and staff that school and the FCPS workplace are places they can be safe from harassment and discrimination. If this vote passes tonight, decisions made regarding accommodations will be provided under revised policy. Our next step will be to hire a consultant to assist us in developing appropriate regulations and best practices to protect the rights of students and comply with state and federal law. The decisions made about how best to protect our students and staff from discrimination, we will take great care in that to protect the rights and to provide for the needs of all students. FCPS will continue to provide the highest quality of education for all students in a safe, supportive, and caring environment. I intend to vote yes to this policy. The motion before us is that I move that the school board adopt policy 1450, non-discrimination, as detailed in the agenda item. All those in favor? Moon, McElveen, Hines, Smith, Derenak, Koufax, Velkoff, McLaughlin, Stork, Strauss, and Evans. Opposed? Schultz. Abstentions? Reed. The motion passes.